Good evening to you. I'm Sean Green with Sports Night. Beginning on the track, Barbadian hurdler Sarah Bell finished third in heat number two of the women's 100-meter hurdles. This is at today's Youth Olympic Games in Argentina to advance to stage two. Her clocking was 14.06. That is behind the eventual winner, Akira Nugent of Jamaica, who won that heat in 13.45 seconds. Let's take a look.
She's in five and has won five out of her six races this year. The two favourites in two and three.
It's a
cold afternoon here, but these women need to warm up quickly, and that's a good start from Nugent, who's a long way clear of Plank. Nugent leading, Plank coming through into her running, and the Barbadian in third, but this is sheer class from the Jamaican. 13.46, Plank second. I think there's more where that came from the Jamaican. Remember, it's the combination of your finishing times across both 100-meter hurdle races that counts. But we'll see Nugent running alongside the likes of the American Stark and White, the Australian, in the superheat in stage two. Good run there from the Jamaican over in lane two.
Yeah, she had a, looked very good technically too. It'll be really interesting when we get into the stage two final, because under pressure with hurdles, there can be lots of mistakes made as well. So I think we'll see a different race when we get into stage two, but a very, very good run from Akira Nugent, only just turned 16. The Jamaicans just have so much natural speed, don't they? And it is the number one sport, without a doubt, in Jamaica.
Well, stage two runs off on Saturday. Well, it was a night of straight sets victories for three of the four games played in the Goddard Enterprises Limited Division I Volleyball League competition at the Wilney Gymnasium last night. In the men, Deacons defeated All Stars in the first game, while defending Kings Cormier handed Foundation United their second loss. In the women, Chargers swept Tasai Club United in the early game, while Phoenix Security Services Carlton delivered an upset to Omega XL Deacons. CBC's Kamal Haynes reports on those games.
All Stars coming off a straight sets defeat and trailing 12-22 in the first set of this game. Akil Williams with a powerful spike piercing the block to claim the point for Deacons. All Stars were under some intense pressure and it showed. Jamar Thompson gifting Deacons yet another point as Deacons take the first set 25-15. Set 2 and Deacons started off with a bang. Russell Blunt as sharp as they come with a spike too hot to handle. Deacons were just as good defensively as they were offensively. Akil Stout solid as a rock with a block, more points for Deacons. All Stars were down but kept on fighting. Jonathan Allen the aggressor, delivering a powerful blow to keep his team in the game. But Deacons proved just too good all the night, taking the final two sets 25-12, 25-22 to hand All Stars their second consecutive straight sets defeat. Second men's game on the night. Cormier the forecourt leading 14-11 against Foundation in the first set, and the defective block outside the line extends that lead. Foundation never once looked like giving up. Kadeem Morris executes the block to good effect to reduce Foundation's deficit by one. Cormier kept on creating good plays. Sean Simpson here with a powerful spike down the right as Cormier takes the first set 25-19. Second set saw Foundation grabbing a few quick early points. But Cormier picked up the slack and went into overdrive, here with a dink. Then Rashad Lovell hammers home the spike, as Cormier would take the second set 25-14, which was enough to win the game 2-1 after going down to Foundation in the final set 14-25. Now to the women. Chargers in the near court had an easy assignment over Club United, up 22-13 here in the first set, as Sherna McPherson fails to return, giving Chargers another crucial point. Chargers would take the first set 25-13 and take a look at why they were the better team on the night. DeShonta Addison puts her body on the line to save the point, and her teammate supports the cause to complete the recovery, gaining a point well deserved. Second set at Club United started off hot, claiming the first point off the spike of Tiandre Stewart. But Charters cooled things down, dominating the second set to win 25-12 before winning the third 25-19 to enjoy a straight sets victory over Club United. To the final game of the night, Carlton in the near court had all to prove against Deacons, and they showed great intentions early. Aisha May got breaks through the wall to give Carlton the point. Deacons looked the part offensively. Shania Boyce hammers one, which is deflected out, to give her side the point. But Charters took advantage of the flaws in Deacons' defense, taking the first set 25-18. Set 2 is where Deacons fought the hardest of the three sets, showing fight and promise of a possible comeback. Julia Morris claims a point for Deacons. But Carlton got everything right on the night, claiming point after point to take the final two sets 25-21, 25-16, delivering a three straight upset to Deacons women. Kamal Haynes, CBC Sports.
On the cricket field, and Cricket USA picked up their first win of the regional Super 50 tournament with a comprehensive 88-run win over the Lewers at Kensington Oval last night. Now, after being dismissed for just 197, the USA returned with the ball to shoot out the Hurricanes for just 109.
Out. First ball. A golden duck. What a start by Singh. That's a good looking shot, a good pull. Going towards the mid-wicket fence. Will get there. Good confident stroke there from young Akeem Saunders to get off the mark. It's pulled away again. This time, back one off square. Another magnificent shot here from young Akeem Saunders, full of confidence.
Beach. Beaten and bowled. That is a wonderful delivery from Sanders. Well, from Hutchison to Sanders.
A taller man will have taken that, but it's gone backward a point for four. That's going to go flying for four. That's in the air and out to mid-wicket. That's four runs. That's in the air. Chance of Wakefield to take the catch, and he doesn't drop many. A crucial wicket. And Phillip gets the man.
Well, that was beautifully played.
And he's gone. Captain Devon Thomas is gone, caught behind. Very good catch.
Beautiful. Beautifully executed inside out.
No, that is ridiculous. What is really going on here?
Bowled him. Drew him forward. Played too early. Beaten in the air, Rakeem Cornwall, and bowled.
This was Kenjiggy's last wicket. Drew the batsman forward, spun away from him sharply, and the keeper did the rest very briskly.
Trouble is his trouble. Here's trouble.
Let's see what happens here. Is it collected cleanly? Yes. And
I think he's out.
I think he's out. I think the stumps are broken before any bat crosses that line. And that's lofted nicely, wide of long off. That's straight down the ground as well. Couple of bounces and into the fence. He's hit. A judge leg before, and it's all over. And the US have gotten on the scoreboard at last.
Meanwhile, in today's ongoing games in Trinidad, Guyana scored 231 in 49 overs. This is against the Windwards, with Shafin Rutherford getting 69. The Windwards are 122 for 7 after 32 overs. And the TNT Red Force, 318 for 9, with Jason Mohammed top scoring with 83. This is against the Windies B, who are 66 for 2 after 12. Well, the Windies have just one more test match ahead of them in the two test series and should fare a bit better with the likes of Kemar Roach and Jason Holder returning. Here now is a preview of that second game.
So the West Indies have found themselves in an all-too-familiar position of late, trailing an away test series after losing the first game inside 3 days. Many fans and players alike have grown accustomed to this once the team leaves the region, regardless of their destination. India is no doubt one of the hardest places for any team in the world to play test cricket, so I don't think anyone will be surprised by the 1-0 scoreline at this point. But let's put things into perspective. The Indians are the undisputed number one test team in the world, while the West Indies are lingering at the bottom of the test table with the likes of Bangladesh and Zimbabwe. Names like Virat Kohli and Chetaswar Pujara are likely to make any inexperienced bowling attack nervous, as these are among the best of the best today, especially at home. The absence of one of our best bowlers in Kemar Roach was indeed a big blow. So too losing the experienced Jason Holder just before the start. It left a gaping hole in an already brittle bowling attack led by the improving Shannon Gabriel, but he's just one man, and the support was surely lacking in Rajkot. Sherman Lewis tried his best, so too did the wicketless Kimo Paul, but these are rookies, bowling to the best in the world in their hunting ground. I believe that with Roach and Holder back, that should strengthen the bowling somewhat to at least limit India below the 400 or 500 mark. Hopefully.
Touching on the injuries which we have, you know, me personally, you know, I'm pushing really hard to be ready for the test match. I felt in the last test match it just wasn't right. I've had a scan, and not too bad in terms of the dynamics of the scan, but it's a matter for me just to manage the pain. You know, it's not been a situation where I've gone on the cricket field 100%, you know, for a very long time, so it's nothing new to me. You know, I'm up for the challenge, I'm up for the fight.
Our batting, though, was the biggest disappointment. Craig Brathwaite never really got going and looked out of sorts on the subcontinent so far, but I'm backing him to come better in the second innings. Kieran Powell was the only one who really challenged the Indians with some success with his counter-attacking style. Maybe more of that is needed somewhere. Shea Hope hasn't been able to build any big innings consistently since his big 100 at Headingley, and he needs to do so. Now, for someone who reels off hundreds at will at the first-class level, I wonder if the Sunil Ambrose that we see in the whites is the same man. Recklessly attacking the bowler without waiting to see what he's bowling is a rookie error. Even I know that. But with his impressive record at the first-class level, I would be a bit more patient with him and pray he doesn't become another Devon Smith, if you know what I mean. Ross and Chase look good, especially in the first innings, and expect him to continue in the same vein, as his record against the Indians is quite good. Davinder Bishu took 4 wickets but went for over 200 runs. That's way too expensive for your frontline spinner. I would consider Jomel Warrican for the second test to see what he's got. So for me, Lewis and maybe Paul will sit out for Roach and Holder, and it's a toss-up between Bishu and Warrican. My batting remains the same. It's just a pity not having Darren Bravo there, still one of the best in the region. He certainly would have made a little difference. West Indies did prevail against the mighty England at Headingley not that long ago, and with the Indians claiming to use this series as a warm-up for Australia, the West Indies should use this thought to their advantage.
Well, the match bowls off at midnight tonight, live on MCTV Sportsmax. And with the second test just about 3.5 hours away, middle-order batsman Rawston Chase doesn't believe that the Windies will repeat the same mistakes as in the first test. So we'll give the West Indians some extra time tonight.
India scoring 600 odd runs is always going to be a hard task, a daunting score on the scoreboard for us to come and surpass that score. I thought that on the first afternoon we batted, the guys were a bit tired, having felt so many overs, so just thought that was our downfall that afternoon. But after that, I thought that we didn't really apply ourselves on the pitch. I thought that the batsmen were trying to be aggressive, which is good, so the bowlers won't always be on top of you. But I thought that sometimes our shot selection was a bit off. We didn't really mix the aggression with defense, and we weren't really in control of our, some of the shots that we were playing. So I just think that's something we need to look at because we attacked early, and when the field was set back, I thought that that's where we struggled after they took away our boundary options. I thought that we didn't really rotate the strike as well as we should, and that is what led to our downfalls.
As you mentioned, Prithvi Shah took you to the cleaners. So do you have any plans, especially for Prithvi Shah now, coming into the next test match?
Well, we had a long chat after the first test match, and we came up with some plans, and we discussed how we're looking to go about bowling at him in the second innings, along with some of the other batters. But I can't obviously discuss our plans in the conference. So, yeah, I think we have a better idea of what we're looking to do against him. Well, the pitch was a good one. It didn't really offer me much spin on the first or the second day. It started to spin for the Indian guys coming on into the third day. But the ball, we got accustomed to the ball because we practiced with them in the camp in Dubai at first. When the ball got a little old, it was a bit slippery. We weren't really accustomed to that. But after having a couple practice with the ball, we got accustomed. So I wouldn't say that that's any excuse for our bowlers. I just think that what we need to do is just find a way to get the ball swinging a bit more, because the Indian fast bowlers had the ball reverse swing really early, and that's something that didn't really happen for us. So I just think that's something we need to look at. I think that would be very helpful for us in the second test.